Hot Up Simple Church fam, welcome back online. We are so excited to be with you, connecting with Jesus and each other. Yeah, that's what we're going to do. We're excited for another great service. Got a one-off message for you this morning that I'm personally excited about.
Yeah, Brandon's going to be delivering that message today.
So I'm excited for you guys to hear that. It's been a blessing to me, and I hope it blesses you as well. And we got some good worship. But before we get into that, as usual, we have some fun to be had. Pre-service
fun, baby.
And so, quick shout out. Our pre-service fam.
Pre-service family.
We love you guys.
Thanks for joining us. Yeah, 15 minutes early.
You guys are the fun ones. They know where the party's at.
Totally.
Because every Sunday morning, we're here 15 minutes before.
That's right.
Having some fun. I've got a challenge for us this morning, Aaron.
This is what
That's
I see
That's why
here.
We've got all these delightful items in front of us. But before we get into that, we just want to remind you guys, we got some notes. Get the message notes. Enhance your message experience by typing notes or texting
notes.
You're not typing. We're texting.
Yeah.
We're texting.
We do this now.
Texting notes to 515-500-2959.
Cool.
Yeah, that's right here. So go ahead and text that. Get those notes sent right to your phone.
Enhance your message
experience. All right, so here we go. Challenge this morning, Aaron.
Okay.
It's going to be a challenge we like to call, or I guess I didn't coin it, but it's the general public likes to call us as people.
What is it called?
Not My Hands Challenge.
The Not My Hands Challenge.
Okay, so what we're going to do for this is basically, it is like it sounds. One of us is going to, we're going to make something. I guess we're both going to do it. We're going to make something. But one of us is going to be the voice of the process.
Yes.
And the other one is going to be the hands.
Of the process.
And so it's not going to be my hands.
It's going to be
your hands.
My hands.
And so therefore, it's a challenge. All right? So we're going to make a peanut butter and jelly. And so I'm going to stick my arms behind me like this.
Okay.
And you're going to bring your hands in between. So here, we family, we brothers.
Oh man, love you, man.
Yeah,
I love you. It's kind of like you love yourself.
Yeah, I love myself. I like giving myself hugs. All right, so we're gonna attempt to make a peanut butter and jelly together. This right here. And we've got all the items we need. We've got the bread. We've got the peanut butter. We've got the peanut butter, right? Right right here, we got the peanut butter. And then we also got that jelly right here. I'm gonna pick it up for you, and I'm gonna show you what kind of jelly it is. It's right here, it is strawberry spread. And here, let me spin it around for you and show you what it. All right, so like any good, you know, process, anytime you go to make your peanut butter and jelly sandwich, You gotta start it right. Okay, right? And so we gotta get the bread out first. We gotta get the bread. So we're gonna grab this bag. We're gonna open it up. We gotta pull that bread out. Yeah, that's a good slice. Look at that. Look at that slice. And toss it down because when you toss it down, it just it just makes it. It enlivens the process. All right, so we're gonna get the next piece of bread because you need two. You need two to make a sandwich. You know this, I know this. And so we got our second piece of bread. And so we put that on the plate. It looked good. You don't really want them stacked on top of each other. That's not a good way to start. And so we're gonna separate them. I'm gonna put one bread on one side of the plate and the other bread on the other side of the plate, like so. Here, let me show you. Let me lift up the plate for you. That's what you want it to look like, okay? All right, then we're gonna set the plate back down. Now, there's a couple ways to make peanut butter and jelly. And really, when it comes to peanut butter and jelly, there's two types of people in this world, okay? There's the type of people that are slightly without, you know, being too, just flawed in their thinking, just a little bit, that's all I'm gonna say. But they like to put peanut butter and jelly on the same piece, or on one piece of bread, like so. And so you have your jelly on one side and your peanut butter on the other side, and then you bring them together, which is fine if you wanna do that. And here, let's start with that, because here's the other, Here's the other way you do it. Here's the right way. No debating. I mean, I guess you can, but I'm gonna tell you otherwise. But you put your peanut butter on both pieces of bread, and then you put your jelly on top of it. And so right now, what kind of person are you? Are you the type of person that puts peanut butter on one side and then jelly on the other? Or do you put peanut butter... do you put peanut butter on both pieces of bread and then put the jelly on? What kind of peanut butter jelly person are you? So with that said, comment in the chat, let us know what kind of peanut butter jelly person are you, and we're gonna get going on the way that I would like to show you, the way that I would encourage, the best way, the correct way, and we're gonna start with peanut butter, okay? So here's the peanut butter, we're gonna open it up, like so, and then, you know, we gotta get rid of that lid, so we're gonna set that down, and then we're gonna, you need a knife, so if you have not got your knife, you wanna get your knife, and you stick it in the peanut butter jar, like so. And you swirl it, you get it in there good. Cause you want a lot of peanut butter. You want a lot of peanut butter. And now today we don't have this, but chunky peanut butter is the best. And then actually, sometimes before you get started, you just wanna test your peanut butter. You wanna take a little taste right off the knife, like so. That's good peanut butter. All right. All right, so then you take the peanut butter and you put it on a piece of bread, like so, just like that. You get one side full, and one side set, and you rip the bread up, and then you set it back down. You set it back down. And then because you don't wanna, you take your knife again, you go back to the peanut butter jar, and you stick it in. Get our peanut butter to go good, like so, okay? And then you you set the peanut butter off to the side, you grab your other piece of bread, and you slather it. You slather it with that peanut butter like that. Yeah, 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 yeah. And then you're done with the peanut butter. So you put the bread back down, and then because we're about, you don't wanna cross-contaminate, You set this knife right here down. And you grab your next knife. Well, first, before you grab the knife, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm getting excited. I'm gonna set this knife back down. And I'm gonna open the jelly jar, because that's what you go for next. You open the jelly jar. So we're gonna grab the jelly. We're gonna open the jar. There you go. Let me smell it. That's good jelly. All right, so now you grab your knife, and again, you stick this in the jar, like so, and you get down in there, and you get a good amount of jelly, because who doesn't like jelly? And then you take it, and you go on one piece of bread. Oh, gosh. And you lather that on the bread, and there you go, you got one done. You got the one done. And then you have to get more jelly. So you grab the jar. Again, you get in there. And you get no jelly at all. That's what you do. Cause I got you. And so I'm gonna go back. There we go, we got some jelly. And then you go to the other piece of bread. Right there. You take that bread. You lather that one up, get the jelly on there, just like that. And then you set it back down on the plate. And now, you would think, we're done. And you just bring it together, but no. There's a secret ingredient. I'm about to show you the secret ingredient. And it is not a banana. I wanna show you first the ingredient you never wanna put on your peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And that is definitely not a banana. You definitely don't wanna do you don't put bananas on your peanut butter and jelly. I know Elvis did, and I know he was good at he was singing, but he was, this is not what you do. This is not what you do. So you throw the banana, you throw it, you get rid of it. You get rid of it. You don't want bananas on your, oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. But there is a secret ingredient you do want to use. There is a secret ingredient you do want to use. And that is chocolate chips, baby. Chocolate chips. Yeah. You got chocolate chips. So we got to open them chocolate chips up. Man, these things are so hard to open, right? Like, you got to find that. And then there we go. We got it. And then so you take the bag. You get in there. You sprinkle it. You just sprinkle that right on. Boom. You know? You just... then you pull... Oh, man. We got the one piece of bread stuck to the bag. So we got to get that off. We got to get that off. Right there. Right like that. Okay, so now you set that one down. And you take your two pieces of bread. You stick them together. like so. You stick them together, and now you've got a peanut butter jelly chocolate chip sandwich. And when you're done, you enjoy it. And so you just take a big old bite. That is good. And so that's how you make a peanut butter and jelly. sandwich. Chocolate chips and not your hands. Oh man. Alright, I'm done.
Wow, this looks pretty good.
How do you think we did, dude?
It's delicious.
Dude, I feel like we could be on like a, you know,
for sure.
A cooking show or something. You look good. Dude, where did that banana come from? I can't believe you did that.
It was a secret ingredient.
Never. No bananas.
Brandon loves bananas.
No. But anyway, dude, that was fun.
That was fun.
That was fun. We hope you guys had fun.
I mean, I didn't really see it go down, but I will eventually.
Yeah, and you kind of, I mean, I'm sure you could have assumed some things. So anyway, we hope you guys had some fun watching us try our hands at the Not My Hand Challenge.
That was good.
Maybe you learned something.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You learn how to make a delicious
peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Speaking of secret ingredients, is there something that you put on your peanut butter and jelly sandwiches?
Yeah.
Maybe a way you do it? Comment in the chat for us. Let us know. Let us know how you do it. Any secret?
I like peanut butter and banana sandwich. Have you ever tried one of those? Peanut butter, well, he has. He hates bananas. But I do like those. Those are good. Pretty good. Some soft bread, chocolate butter, banana. Oh, I'm stepping on a banana.
Oh no!
Who threw the banana on the ground?
So with that, see you guys. We're gonna see you in the chat. Love ya.
Peace.
Tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken.
Why?
'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Come on. Oh, shame no longer has a place to hide. And I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken, no. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
There's power, come on.
There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out the grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Yeah. Sing that again one more time. Come on.
Oh, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, I'm standing in your love.
Yeah,
standing. Our love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Yeah. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs. We pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Mm.
You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore,
you restore
every heart that is broken. Yeah. Oh, and great are you, Lord.
It's your breath.
It's your breath. pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, holy. All the earth will shout, come on. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Sing that again. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Come on, one more time. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, Lord.
Simple Church, so great to be gathered online with you. There's a verse in John chapter 1 verse 5 that says, "The light shines in the darkness and the darkness has not overcome it." Man, that light is Jesus, and no matter what is going on in the world, no matter the darkness and evil that we see, no matter what is going on, we have hope and we have faith and we wait with excitement and anticipation because we know that sin and death has been overthrown. We only have to skip to the last pages in the Bible to read the ending. Every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. Every tear will be wiped away. God has made a way through Jesus for the whole world to come back to his perfect love and to live a life in his glory and splendor. How awesome is our God. We're so excited to praise him today. If you are new to Simple Church or just checking us out for the very first time, we know that life is really hard no matter who you are, and we don't want you to do it alone. You can click the link in the chat to connect with us or text online to 515-500-2959. You know, we mean it when we say we want to connect with you because we know God loves you deeply and has big, bold plans for your life, and we want to help you take any next steps to connect with him and each other. So today we have a message from Pastor Brandon called Rhythm. Remember when I said life was really hard? Well, Brandon's got a great message for us that looks at how the time we use in our day, the rhythm of our daily life, can contribute to the difficulties we face, and how we can, with the wisdom from God's word in the Bible, change that. So you can follow along with the message by grabbing today's message notes. Click the link in the chat or text NOTES to 515-500-2959. But first, let's take a moment to give back. We have two simple ways to give digitally. First, you can give through our website at simple.church and click give, or you can text the word simple to 77977. Again, that's just simple, S-I-M-P-L-E, to 77977 and follow the link to give via text. If you would like to give another way, like by mail, you can head to our website, simple.church, and check out the info there. When you give, whether it be of your time, your talents, or your treasures, you are partnering with us to make an impact on our community, all of Des Moines even, for the love and light of Jesus, and watch life change happen for God's glory and God's kingdom. What a great purpose God has given to us. Thank you for carrying that purpose into your homes and workplaces and communities. Deuteronomy 16:17 says, "Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God that he has given you." Whether you're giving your talents, your time, your treasures, thank you for the impact you're making through Simple Church on Des Moines for the glory of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us all here together online, God. Father, we just lift up the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord, and we just pray that you would remove all distractions, God, that you would open our ears and our hearts to hear your word, to let them speak to us personally. And Father, we pray that you would help us apply that to our daily life, that we would walk away from this time being closer to you and looking more like your Son, Jesus. Father, thank you for all the things that you're doing in and through Simple Church. We pray for our church. We pray for not just the people in our church, but the church as a whole, that you would continue to favor us through the ways that we serve our community and the ways that we are able to proclaim your name. Thank you again for this time. We give all of this to you for your Son's glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Is that you? Do these words speak to you? Tired, worn out, burned out? As I reflect on the past couple weeks and even months, I know I certainly do. And I relate with those words. Those words just hit me different, right? And that's why I'm excited to share with you why I believe God has placed this portion of scripture and this message on my heart. And I pray that those of you who need it would be blessed as I have these past couple weeks, as I've gotten to reflect on what I believe Jesus is trying to say here in Matthew. My name is Brandon, and I'm the youth pastor here at Simple Church. And as I've already stated, I get the privilege of sharing a message with you, a message I am simply titling Rhythm, because I don't want you to miss it. Rhythm is so important. And as we get started, I just want to let you guys know, like, I feel like I have a little bit of rhythm. And to show you what I mean by that, I gotta be vulnerable with you just a second and let you know that yes, I have a TikTok. And I've taken my chances at, you know, conquering a little bit of some of the rhythm that you have to have while being on there. And just so you know, if you're curious, my TikTok is at @PruittBrandon. You can follow me, give me some likes, make me feel good. But anyway, to give you a taste of my rhythm, I want to show you the very first TikTok I ever made. And I'm not even going to say anything else. Just here you go. Check it out. I can't believe I'm showing you guys this. Check it out.
Okay.
So yeah, that's the first TikTok I ever made, you guys. And despite what you may think of it, I look back and I gotta be honest, it's embarrassing. I mean, did you see what I was wearing? Like, I thought, yeah, it's my day off. I'm just gonna be chill, I'm gonna be cool. I'm gonna show up in my joggers and my long shirt and you know, and do my thing. And I mean, if you just look at me, you can see like, man, look how cool I think I am. Like, it's ridiculous, right? Like, I didn't even, you wouldn't know this maybe watching it, but I didn't even set the camera up right. I had this desk that I set out in our living room and had to put a book on it and then had to set my phone up, you know, on the book, and I didn't have a tripod at that point and all this stuff. And I just look back on that and I go, man, what was I doing? But despite what you think of that first TikTok of mine and whether you found that to be, oh, wow, that was kind of cool, or like, oh, nice try, bro. Like, whatever you think of it, here's maybe something you don't realize is that 10 to 15 second video took me over an hour to make. Why? Because I had to get in sync with the song. I had to find my rhythm. I had to find the rhythm of the song and figure my body had to learn that rhythm and be able to be okay with it and figure it out and dance along with it. But before I could even have the confidence to begin doing that, I had to know that rhythm. And even beyond that, like, I had to figure out the rhythm of TikTok. Like, I had never used it before. I had to figure out the best way to hit record and retry and all that. And you may have not even noticed this, but I walked away from the screen because I didn't even know how to use the timer on TikTok yet. And for any of you, those of you who use TikTok, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But if I was to be really honest with you, as I look back on that first TikTok, I really had in my mind, like, man, what if I post this and I go viral? Like, you know, I see all these friends doing it and keep trying, and what if it just blows up and people, I mean, that would be really cool. And I think about that, and that honestly went through my mind. And I think about that thought, and no, it didn't go viral. Again, 40 views, 4 likes, that's nothing in TikTok, in TikTok world. But, you know, I think back on that thought, and as I think about it, I realize whether we are willing to admit it or not, many of us think the same way. We see others getting it right, living a life of whatever we define as success, and we tell ourselves, or we feel led to accomplish that very thing. We tell ourselves, well, I'm gonna do that. I can do that. I can be like that. Yet many of us fall short, right? Like, many of us fall short of that accomplishment because we don't consider what's going on BTS, behind the scenes. We don't see the responsibility and repetition it takes to get there. But in reality, whether it's TikTok, whether it's TV, whether it's your workplace, whether it's a friend group or people at school, anyone that you've seen that has peace with what they're doing and has found success, I guarantee you there's a level of rhythm that they have formed in their lives. And so I want to speak over you today that if you don't feel like you have that in your life, it's possible. And I believe the words of Jesus that we find in Matthew 11, where we'll be reading today, can give us perspective on how to make that possible in our lives. And so to get us started, to gain some perspective on what Jesus is saying here, I want to take us to the beginning of where this statement originated. Like, why is he even saying it? And so we jump to the beginning of Matthew 11, where we are told this. Matthew tells us, when Jesus finished placing this charge before his 12 disciples, he went on to teach and preach in their villages. John, meanwhile, that's John the Baptist, had been locked up in prison. When he got wind of what Jesus was doing, he sent his own disciples to ask, are you the one we've been expecting, or are we still waiting? What was going on around John didn't match his expectations. And this portion of Matthew's account has always intrigued me. See, if you know anything about John the Baptist, you'll know that a few chapters earlier, this dude is like confident, right? Like it tells us, Matthew tells us that he was out in the wilderness and he, you know, the accounts we read of him, he wore camel's hair, he ate locusts and honey, but everyone flocked to him because he was pronouncing something. He would tell people, the Messiah is coming. This guy is gonna baptize you with fire. I baptize with water. He's gonna baptize you with fire. And then this guy, Jesus, shows up on the scene and it tells us that he declared, this is he, this is the guy. And you would look at John and the way he lived and the things he did. And you'd be like, that guy is confident. That guy knows who he is, and what he's supposed to do. But yet in Matthew 11, we see a very different side of John. We see a John that doubts. And so when I read this, I have to stop and go, why? And you'll notice it says he's in prison, right? And so I begin to imagine John in prison in a different setting than he's used to, right? Like he's surrounded by guards instead of his friends. He's sleeping on cement instead of whatever, you know, he slept on in the wilderness or whatever he used to sleep, but it's still different, right? His diet might be different because I doubt that the guards are going out to get locusts and honey for him. I mean, that's not my diet, but like, it's different. And I imagine he began to look different and feel different. And as we read that he told his disciples to go talk to Jesus, I imagine that they were coming to visit him regularly. And I wonder if they started to notice this of John too and go, whoa, 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 John, you're not you. You look different. You're acting different. Imagine they began to say things to him because they noticed that John was changing, that his demeanor, his confidence was changing. Man, this isn't you. You look different. And I wonder if you've ever felt that way. I know I have. Maybe you feel this way right now. Maybe you don't feel like you. I mean, let's just be real. Things have changed these past couple weeks and months. And maybe you have people around you telling you, this isn't you. You're different. And maybe you've even told yourself that. But the real question is, what do we do when we feel this way? What do you do? What do we do when others are telling us this? Because if you're anything like me in this moment, you're filled with sorrow, right? Like you're filled with defeat. You begin to notice this about yourself and you begin to like get down on yourself and you feel that sorrow, that weight of hopelessness. But I want to stop there and let you in on something I've learned. Sorrow can be used for good if used in the correct way. Paul expresses this in 2 Corinthians 7. He says, "For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death." And so Paul tells us here, there is a sorrow God wants us to experience. Don't miss that. God wants us to experience? Why? Paul tells us, he says, to lead us away from sin and result in salvation. Pain and sorrow could be a real gift to us if we would approach it in the right way. Pain and sorrow is there to tell us something, right? But it's our decision what we do with it. And I'm encouraged by what John decided to do with his sorrow. He went to Jesus. He came to him, or rather he sent his disciples to him and inquired as to why he was feeling the way he was.
I mean, did you notice that? He goes to Jesus and he says, this isn't matching my expectations. I don't feel the way I did before. I see this differently. Tell me why. Is this what I think, is what I feel, give me direction. And as I think about this, I'm reminded of a moment in Amy and I's life, my wife Amy, where all of a sudden her heart started to feel different. And we didn't know this at the time, but she started to get what's called heart flutters. And she would literally have to sit down or stop and just take a break because it felt so weird. And it like took her aback and she just had to chill for a minute. It was offbeat. It felt weird. Her heart was out of rhythm. And what do you think we did? Did we just go, well, that sucks. I guess we'll just have to deal with that. No, we didn't. We noticed that there was something wrong, that her heart was off, and we went to someone who would know more. We went to the doctor and discovered, and I can't begin to tell you or remember what the name of it was, but that she was experiencing these heart flutters. And the reason I bring that up is because I imagine many of you would do the same. If you started to feel something off with your heart, or started to feel something off even anywhere in our body or in our mind, like what do? We go to someone with expertise and go, I'm not feeling, there's something out of place here. I'm out of rhythm. Help me understand why. But yet when it comes to our life, and especially our spiritual life, for some reason we don't do this. We tell ourselves, I'll figure it out. I can do it on my own. I don't need other people. I certainly don't need suffers. Oh, Jesus, I got this. And I would encourage you, I would encourage us to take one from John and heed our heartbeat. I encourage you to heed your heartbeat. If something is off in your life, if you feel that, if the words I spoke to you at the beginning of this of feeling tired or worn out or burned out, if that's a reality for you, don't ignore it. Don't ignore it. Instead, pray about it. Go to Jesus with it, but also go to the people that he has surrounded you with, loved ones, and talk to them about it and get their thoughts, get a perspective on it so you can begin to walk in a direction that is going to see freedom from that anxiety or being worried or being worn out or burnt out. Don't ignore it. Just like Amy and I heeded what was going on with her heartbeat, don't ignore what's going on in your life. And so that's my first realization from what John experienced here, and I think is very applicable to us today, is I encourage you to heed your heartbeat. Because again, this is what John does. He goes to Jesus and Jesus responds. And so Jesus responds, John asks this question and he responds to John or his disciples rather, and he addresses the crowd about John and he says some things about him and it kind of explains like this isn't a bad thing. John is still one of the greatest men to ever live. And then he basically tells them that if they don't heed their heartbeat like John does, they will end up worse off than some of the worst cities they can think of. He says places like Tyre and Sidon and Sodom, which are cities in the old, you know, as you read in the Old Testament, that those people would have known very well. It didn't turn out so well for them. And he says, you'll be worse off than them if you don't heed your heartbeat. And then after he tells them this, he begins to praise God. And then he responds by saying this, what we just read at the beginning of our time together. He says, Jesus says, are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Let the unforced rhythms of grace. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Jesus speaks to everyone there as almost to say, are you feeling the same way as John? Do you feel worn out and tired? Well, I have a solution for you. And he doesn't tell them and he doesn't tell us. It's not a pill. It's not a self-help book. It's not a one-liner piece of advice or a good message, even though those are good things. No, he says, get away with me. Walk with me. Learn from me. The fix you and I's life, the fix to you and I's life feeling out of whack isn't something solved overnight. It's not a quick fix. It's something that's learned. It's a process. It's a rhythm. And I think about over the past couple months why this has become so important to me is because I have felt what Jesus is talking about. I mean, just to be real with you guys, my rhythm, I got to a point where it felt completely out of whack. I mean, maybe you can relate. Before this whole pandemic went down, before we got at where we're at now, and not to even mention some of the other things going on in our world, like I had a rhythm, right? Like I had a schedule. I had days that I went to my coffee shop. Shout out to Freedom Blend Coffee. They're so good. If you haven't been there, go there. They're legit. But that was my spot. I had people I saw there. I had coffees that I would regularly buy. I knew that was a part of my rhythm. I had days that I did certain work. I had days that I was free to meet certain people. I had a time I would get up, a time I would go to bed. Like I had a rhythm, right? And then everything changed. Everything changed and I threw that off. And I imagine many of you can relate. Maybe it's not exactly the same as me, but I imagine many of you, as I explain that, can relate to that. And yet, I wonder if you can relate to the fact that for me, when I first got thrown off, I just shrugged it off. I began taking things day by day, which I think at the beginning of change, like that's just what we do. Right? Like that's all you can do. You have to take it day by day because you haven't even begun time to process. But then even as I got time to process, I just kept going with it. Like I just ignored it. And what I found is that as I continued to do that, I noticed I felt more groggy, irritated, unsatisfied, and unpurposeful. I would wake up many mornings just feeling like junk. And I would get through the end of my days and regret my day. And feel like I didn't accomplish anything. I didn't fulfill my purpose. I let people down. I let myself down. And I would feel like that at the end of the day. But why? Why? I had all this extra time. I mean, let's be real. Like I had extra time. But the key was I wasn't intentional with it. Because it was left so open that I was like, this is what we have. This is what I got. I'm just gonna keep going. But it didn't help. And I found myself doing things like I would scroll Instagram too long or TikTok or I'd play video games whenever I felt like it. Or I would just go to sleep when I felt like it because it was like, it doesn't matter. I can wake up whenever I want to tomorrow. Or I left my time with God and time to with my family up to chance. And I would find myself spending less and less time with those I cared about the most. I let my work decide what I was doing each day instead of deciding the work I would do that day. And again, maybe you can relate with this. Maybe you felt like that this past couple weeks, months. But what I want to tell you is that I've begun to find freedom from that. And it's when I started learning new rhythms. I went to Jesus. I went to others. To discover a new set of rhythms in my life. But the key there is I had to relearn it. And so now what that rhythm looks like for me, and as I share these with you, this is not the way that you should do it. It's just how I do it. And I'm still learning and I'm still processing and I'm still refiguring out the best rhythm because again, it takes time. Jesus says, walk with me, learn from me, do it, watch me and do as I do. And so what that's looked like for me is I've had to set a new time in the morning with my Creator to start my day that way, because that's what works for me. I found that that's a rhythm that is important to my life. I've set times for specific types of work each day. I know during the certain day, like what kind of work I'm gonna do and when. I've set time with my family. I've set times, even set times for when to play games and when to be on social media. And that gives me freedom. Tom says this all the time. Our calendar doesn't restrict us, but it sets us free. Setting rhythms in our life does not restrict us, but it sets us free. And that may sound a little extreme to you, but just think about it. Just think about it. All of us know what rhythms look like in our life. But the reality is that many of them have been forced, right? Like many of them have been forced in our life, whether it's work or school for you, or maybe even your parents telling you what to do. All of us have had rhythms in our life that have been forced. And most of us at some point complain about those rhythms. I don't like my job. I wish I could change my job, or like, man, school sucks. Like, I don't want to do school. My mom's always ragging on me, or maybe for you, it's your wife or your husband or what, or they're always nagging on me, whatever. There's forced rhythms. But here's what's ironic. I can't tell you how many times I've heard the past month someone telling me, now that those have been taken away, that they miss them and they wish they had them back. Many of us who've said we hate school or don't like our job, it's just like, man, I wish I could be back at work. I wish I could be back at school. And this is why I love what Jesus says and why I think it's so important. He says, learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I love that, because he says unforced rhythms of grace. He isn't forcing us into anything, but he is inviting us. And it's on us to learn those rhythms. And I think it's so important that that's the perspective we have, because again, when we're forced into rhythm, even though rhythm is good, at some point we're gonna start complaining about it because it wasn't our choice. And so he doesn't force us into anything, but instead invites us into something that he knows will bless our lives. And then we have to choose it. And that may look different between you and I. It may look different for each of you. Your rhythm may need to be different than mine. You may not, getting up in the morning and starting your time with God may not be the best time for you. Maybe it's the afternoon, maybe it's the evening. I spend time with my family. I have 2 hours set aside most evenings to spend time with my wife and daughter. Maybe that isn't the best time for you. Maybe you know, giving yourself time to do things that you enjoy as far as like video games, social media, Netflix, whatever that is. Again, mine is like at certain points, and maybe that's different for you, but here's the key. You have to learn a rhythm. Well, I guess you don't have to. But Jesus certainly encourages it. He says, learn my rhythm. Learn from me. Watch what I do. And so your rhythm may need to be different, but here's what I'm going to encourage you with. It'll look different. It won't be like anybody else's. But we have to find and commit to it. And so the second thing I want to encourage you with is learn your rhythm. Heed your heartbeat. Find out where things are off. Really reflect and have people speak into your life, but then take that and learn your rhythm. Start somewhere. Commit to something. And as I say that, this may be the point where you're going, Brandon, bro, that sounds like a lot of work, man. Like, that sounds like a lot of work. I got enough to worry about right now. Like, you want me to start learning a whole new process for things and learning a new rhythm? Like, I've got enough to worry about from my day to day. I've got my own, I've got a rhythm that I've got to figure out like right now. I've got enough to worry about. Why should I take the time to learn a brand new rhythm? And what Jesus says next, what he finishes his response with, I think gives you and I the answer as to why we should really consider finding and learning our rhythm. He says, I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Let me ask you something. How does that sound to you? How are your rhythms working for you right now? Do you feel like you're living freely and lightly? And if not, would you like to? I know I do. I know I want to. And see, most translations here, you know, if you like read NLT, NIV, whatever, like they'll use the word rest. But I like in the Message version, and that's why I chose that translation for our time today, is because it says freely and lightly. Because here's the thing, I think we often equate rest with sleep, right? Like we equate rest with being able to lay down and just be done and pass out, because honestly, that's the only time that many of us have an opportunity to feel like we're free and light. That's just rest, sleep is the only rhythm we've allowed in our lives. The only time we've allowed ourselves to get away from the busyness of life, sleep becomes the only rhythm we have. Yet this word rest is also used in Genesis. After God finished creating the universe, we are told after 6 days of creating and working, he rested on the seventh. And if you pay attention, you'll notice as you read the creation story, there is a rhythm. At the end of each one, it says, you know, and there was night and then there was day and it was good. Every portion, there's a rhythm in place. And at the end of that, God comes into rest. He finds rest in the rhythm. And I say come is into rest because I think that better describes what the authors tell us his experience is here and what he intends as our experience. This word rest in Hebrew comes closer to our English context of settling in, of really settling in and feeling like, man, we're good, I'm Gucci, like this is good, right? A way that I can think about it is say you go on vacation, right? There's that time you're prepping and you get packed and then you have to deal with the planes and all that stuff. And then you get there and you have to unpack, but then there's a point you reach where you feel like I'm settled in. I'm good. I just get to enjoy. I just get to do. Or maybe for you, it's not vacation. I don't know, you know, maybe you don't get to take as many vacations as our pastor, but like maybe for you, it's a weekend, right? Like you reach the end of your work week, you know, on Friday night, you gotta come home and maybe shower, get ready. And then there's a point you reach where you just settle in to the weekend and you just get to do. You get to be you. You get to enjoy. And don't hear me wrong in this. I think there's still work and rest. There's still work and settling in. But even when we work, whether it's on vacation or it's the weekend, it's enjoyable, right? Like there's still things you have to do. There's still things you have to go out and make an effort for, but we find fulfillment and satisfaction in it. It doesn't feel like work. It's work, but it doesn't feel as much so because we enjoy it. We feel like, man, this is what I was meant to do. Like this is what I want to do. And God's intention for your life is not that you would get one weekend or a week away a year to experience this, but that every day you would begin to find rest, that you would get a chance to settle into what God has for you while still here on this earth. And I can tell you, as I've begun to be intentional about setting rhythms in my own life, I have found that. When I spend time with my Creator in the morning, when I spend time with my family in the evening, and when I'm doing my work during the day, I've begun to find more satisfaction and more purpose and more enjoyment in it. And so here's why I want to encourage you to heed your heartbeat and to learn your rhythm. Because ultimately, rest is found in rhythm. Rest is found in rhythm. And I want that for you. I want you to get through your day, your week. I want to do that. I think God wants us to do that. To feel satisfied. To feel purposeful. To feel good about it. And that's not saying that life is always going to feel good. It's going to throw, you know, curveballs, if you will, at us. It's, you know, speed bumps, whatever you know, whatever metaphor you go with. But those are going to come up. But ultimately, God has a purpose for you and I. And he wants us to find purpose in that. To find satisfaction. To find rest. And so in short, my message and my encouragement to you is to do one of two things. Heed your heartbeat. If you're feeling off, don't ignore it. If you're feeling out of whack, don't ignore it. Don't tell yourself like, I'll just get over it. I got to deal with it. Don't ignore it. Jesus never abandons you and never forsakes you. And not only that, he's placed people in your life that care about you and love you. If you're part of this Simple Church family, I guarantee you that. There's people here who care about you. Life is hard, y'all, but we're never meant to do it alone. And God has surrounded us with community. And not only that, he is constantly with us. And so if you're feeling off, don't ignore it. Take it to others and take it to Jesus. In Philippians, Paul tells us that when we go to God and we tell him what we need and thank him for what he has done, we will experience peace beyond our understanding. We will experience, I would argue, we experience rest when we do that. And so take it to him and take it to the people that he has surrounded yourself with. Heed your heartbeat. Don't ignore it. That's the first thing I want to encourage you with. And secondly, is learn your rhythm. As that comes up for you and you begin to get perspective and things on that, like begin to learn your rhythm. Commit to it. Commit to learning a new rhythm. Decide what that needs to be for you. And again, that may be different for you and it may need to start small. It may be something as simple as you've not had a specific time you go to sleep or maybe a certain time you eat or even brush your teeth. Like maybe you need to start there. But find a rhythm and commit to it. Things like, when are you going to spend time with God? When are you going to spend time with your family? When are you going to do the things throughout your day? And it's going to take discipline. But even though discipline's hard, none of us want to be undisciplined. And discipline gives us rhythm. And rhythm, again, is where we'll find rest. And so I encourage you, heed your heartbeat, learn your rhythm, and you'll find rest. But with all that said, I want you to know I'm still learning it, you guys. I'm still growing in this. I'm sharing this with you as I've begun to experience it. I'm not perfect in it. I'm still figuring it out. It's taken me time. I mean, I still remember at the beginning of this pandemic that we've faced, I started to feel the weight of this. And I feel like just now, I'm beginning to experience a rhythm that I feel blessed with. But there's still like moments where I go, man, why did I do that? Or I look back and I'd be like, why didn't I start this way? Why haven't I already begun this? And I want to encourage you not to get discouraged by that. That's what I love about what Jesus says of walk with me and learn with me, because it's a process. It takes time. But if you commit to it, you will begin to see the blessings. And that's what I want to encourage you with, is it has taken me time. And it's going to take a constant effort of going to Jesus both in prayer and to the people he has placed around you, the people he has placed around me, to learn and become fluent in the new rhythms that I need and the new rhythms that you need. But I can tell you, as I've done this, I've begun to find rest. And again, I want that for you. I want that for you. So I'm encouraging you, whatever this means for you today, learn the unforced rhythms of grace that Jesus offers you. Heed your heartbeat, learn your rhythm, and find your rest. I love you guys. And I'm praying for you. In fact, I want to pray for you right now. And I pray that you will find that rest in your life. God, I come to you right now. And I thank you so much for your words, what you've spoken to us through the biblical authors and the way that we get to learn and gain perspective through their words, your words. And I pray that whoever needed this the most today, I pray for each person on the other side of this screen, that they would begin to find this in their own life if they have not yet. And even if they have, I pray that they're encouraged to continue it. I pray that they begin to find what that rhythm is for them, and they begin to experience the rest that you intend for them. You are so good, Father, and your ways are so perfect. And I pray that each of us would know that and feel that and experience that in our lives. I love this church family. I'm praying for them. I hope they know that. And yeah, God, your name, amen.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. 'Cause you are way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, and that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every life. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, I worship you, I worship you. feel that you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Waymake, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymake, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Hey everybody, thanks so much for gathering here online. And while it's been amazing the way God has provided a platform to sing together, to learn together, and to grow together online during this season, we're so excited to be meeting together again in person on Sunday, June 28th. And that's only 2 weeks away. And while we are relying on you to take personal responsibility on deciding when is the right time for you to gather in person, we're taking significant steps to ensure that Simple Church is safe and clean space for you to connect with God and with each other. So head to simple.church/comeback for all the details there. And we hope to see you on June 28th. And hey, if you're not quite ready to come back or be able to join us in person, we're still going to be gathering here online, right here at simple.online.church. So whether you're in person or online, we'll see you then at 10 a.m. on June 28th. So thanks again so much for being a part of this movement. Or if you're just checking us out, thanks for being here. Our prayer is that we can all grow closer to God and to each other. Next week is Father's Day, so we've got plenty of fun in store. So cook some extra bacon and join us at 10 a.m. for a great service. Since we can't do our annual Father's Day cornhole tournament with you, we have something special in store during the pre-service fun. So be sure to jump on 15 minutes early on Father's Day to check that out. Now, we're gonna head to the Zoom room. So if you can, Brandon will be posting a link for the Zoom room where you can connect there. And some of us will be staying here in the chat to connect and talk more about today's message as well. It's been such a blessing to be here with you today, and have a great rest of your day, and hope to see you next week.